Well, of course, you know, patients of African descent are all colors of the spectrum. So I think we have to just open our minds up to what all skin types look like with every disease. And I think then we don't miss it and we don't minimize how severe it is when we're taking care of those patients.
That's Dr. Amy McMichael, and this is Dermatology Weekly, the weekly podcast from MD Edge Dermatology. I'm MD Edge editor Elizabeth Mishkati.
And I'm MD Edge editor Terry Rudd. Today, pediatric atopic dermatitis is more prevalent in African American children. Dr. Lynn McKinley-Grant, president of the Skin of Color Society, talks with Dr. Amy McMichael about the quality of life impact on pediatric patients with AD, as well as skin care in this population. They also discuss the clinical presentation of AD in the skin of color population.
In the news, we have results of studies on a potential new treatment for severe prurigo nodularis and a device that might reduce the number of office visits needed for laser tattoo removal. And another study looks at the increased risk of cancer associated with psoriasis.
You can reach Dermatology Weekly by emailing us at podcasts@mdedge.com. You'll also find that email address in the podcast description.
And now the news.
Nemolizumab achieved rapid and clinically meaningful improvement in both itch and skin lesions in a study of patients with severe prurigo nodularis. Dr. Sonja Stander is professor of the University of Münster in Germany. She presented the study results at the annual Congress of the European Academy of Dermatology and Venereology. In the phase 2b randomized trial, pruritus began to improve during the first week of treatment with the investigational interleukin-31 receptor inhibitor, and lesions started to heal at week 4. The European study randomized 70 patients with severe prurigo nodularis to subcutaneous nemolizumab or placebo at week 0, 4, and 8, then followed off therapy out to week 18. The primary endpoint was the percentage decrease in the peak pruritus score from baseline to week 4, at which point patients had received one dose. The nemolizumab group averaged a 53% reduction, compared with 15% in controls. At week 12, a full month after the final injection, the split was 63% versus 20%. And at week 18, the nemolizumab group maintained a mean 58% reduction from baseline versus 21% in controls. Among the secondary endpoints was achievement of an investigator global assessment score of 0 or 1, meaning clear or almost clear of skin lesions. The rate in the nemolizumab group climbed steadily from week 4 on, reaching 38%, and it was still rising without a plateau at week 18. In controls, however, the rate was roughly 6%. Dr. Stander says the results confirm that IL-31 signaling is an important therapeutic target in this disease. And she adds that nemolizumab's arrival is a promising potential therapy for severely affected patients.
A device that uses sound waves to clear skin cells can allow more laser passes in a single tattoo removal treatment session, and that could potentially reduce the number of office visits needed to remove a tattoo. Dr. Michael Kaminer of Skin Care Physicians in Chestnut Hill, Massachusetts, and his co-authors pointed out that tattoos are most often removed with short-pulse, high-fluence lasers, such as a neodymium YAG Q-switch laser. But the QS laser is limited in its ability to affect the tattoo ink pigment particles in each treatment session. That's because the pigment particles are shielded in part by laser-induced epidermal and dermal vacuoles, known as whitening. That means it takes 10 or more sessions using the QS laser to achieve adequate fading of the tattoo. In a single-center prospective trial, Dr. Kaminer and colleagues evaluated whether using a rapid acoustic pulse, or RAP, device could clear vacuoles and thus reduce the whitening effect. That could then make it possible to increase the number of potential laser passes. The study included patients with Fitzpatrick skin types 1 through 3. They treated 32 black ink tattoos in 21 patients, dividing the tattoos into three zones, one that received at least three consecutive laser passes, alternating with a minute of treatment with the wrap device, one that received single pass laser treatment, and one that received no treatment. After 12 weeks, the average percent fading was significantly higher in the laser plus wrap zones compared with the zones treated with only the laser. The percentages of tattoos with more than 50% fading and more than 75% fading were also significantly higher in the areas treated with the laser and the wrap device compared with the areas treated with the laser only. The researchers plan to evaluate use of the wrap device to remove other tattoo ink colors in a broader range of skin types. The findings appear in the journal Lasers in Surgery and Medicine.
Compared with a psoriasis-free population, having a diagnosis of severe psoriasis was linked with a 22% greater overall risk of cancer mortality. That's according to a meta-analysis by researchers at the University of Manchester in England. The analysis included 58 observational studies that reported on cancer incidence or cancer mortality. For all severities of psoriasis combined, the researchers found an 18% increase in cancer mortality risk. The analysis also included mortality risk for specific cancer types associated with psoriasis. Risk increases range from 18% for colon cancer and 28% for non-Hodgkin lymphoma to 105% for esophageal cancer and 180% for oral cancers. The researchers caution that an underlying mechanism is still unclear, but the chronic inflammation that drives psoriasis can also drive the development of cancer. And the study authors note that immunomodulatory therapies for psoriasis may also play a part. Given their findings, they recommend that clinicians stress lifestyle modifications known to decrease cancer risk. The study was published in JAMA Dermatology. We'll be right back after this message. And now, Dr. Lynn McKinley-Grant and Dr. Amy McMichael.
Today, I'm talking with Dr. Amy McMichael about atopic dermatitis in adolescents with skin of color. Dr. McMichael is chair of the department at Wake Forest School of Medicine in Winston-Salem, North Carolina. She is also past president of the Skin of Color Society and currently on the board of directors of the American Academy of Dermatology. Dr. McMichael, thank you so much for joining us today.
Oh, it's my pleasure. Thank you, Lynn, for having me.
We'll start with just a few questions, and this is about your article in Cutis on atopic dermatitis in adolescents with skin of color. Why is pediatric atopic dermatitis more prevalent in black children?
Yeah, you know, I don't know that we have an answer for that question. You know, we do know that certainly it is more prevalent. But when we look at the basic science behind it, we don't really have good answers. You know, there is a definite knowledge that losing the function of some of the well-studied genes, like the FLG or filaggrin gene, is a risk factor for developing atopic dermatitis. But the mutation with the loss of the function of the filaggrin gene is much more likely to be in non-African-American patients with atopic dermatitis. So we don't really know what the genetic mutations are that make it more common in African-American patients, but we know that that is the case.
Mm-hmm. And some people will relate it to just being atopic and the asthma and then the mites in the environment. But as you said, it's just more prevalent at this
point.
Yeah,
we don't know. You know, I mean, certainly we know all of the atopy is certainly a lot more common in that population. But I don't think we really have a good explanation for why, you know.
Yeah.
It all does go together, and we certainly see it every day in our clinics. But we don't know why. Yeah.
One of the articles that you mentioned in your article was the study that was done with children missing school who have atopic dermatitis and the impact on their school attendance record.
Yeah, it's really a major issue. And I'll just say this before I talk about how we put the study in the paper. You know, I actually grew up with a young woman who had very, very severe atopic dermatitis. We were in kindergarten through third grade together. She lived in my neighborhood. And I remember the taunting that she received, you know, why does this young woman have alligator skin? Why does she look that way? And she did miss quite a lot of school. She had total coverage of her skin. And I remember this, you know, as easily as I remember, you know, anything else from my childhood. This is really very prominent. And she missed a lot of school. And when I ran into her mother years later, I was, I think, maybe a resident in dermatology at the time. You know, I had already graduated from college and medical school and was in my residency. And her mother, you know, asked me what I was doing, and I told her. And she said, with really the same amount of excitement as you one might say, you know, somebody's graduated from medical school and in a residency, going to practice medicine, she told me that her daughter had made it to the homecoming queen court in college.
Oh.
And at the moment I thought, wow, that's different than going to medical school. And then I thought, well, wait a minute, you know, for her it isn't. This is, you know, finally a time where she can shine as herself. And I mm-hmm. think that was a major thing for them, and it would be for any young woman who grew up with really severe eczema. So it's not just, of course, about the way this person looks. It's about, you know, their constant itching, inability to study, inability to concentrate, but it means that much. But getting back to the school absences, you know, what has been seen is that children ages 2 to 17 certainly have increased absences as compared to who are African-American have increased absences compared to white children with atopic dermatitis. And that study noted that black children had a 1.5 times higher chance of being absent 6 days because of their skin disorder. And so that's really over a 6-month school period than non-Hispanic black children and had significantly higher chronic absenteeism compared to white children. So if you have people who are missing 6 days of school in a 6-month period and other people aren't missing that much school, it's going to be a real problem. And they're mm-hmm. going to have trouble keeping up. And it's already a problem and it's already an issue for them to stay focused in class because they're constantly itching and uncomfortable, and perhaps sometimes they don't feel well if there's an infection that's affecting their skin, et cetera. So I think that this is something we don't really think about very deeply, or maybe we kind of think about it, but we push it off. But when those patients come to see us in clinic, we need to address that with parents. You know, how are you helping them keep up with their work? You know, what kinds of help are they getting at school? Those are questions we as dermatologists can ask.
Yeah, I think also that, as you were saying, that the sleep factor has got to be a major factor of this too, because those children don't sleep. If you've ever been around someone with any topic, like your best friend with, you know, who maybe spent the night, they're scratching all night long,
mm-hmm.
and parents don't sleep. You know, I mean, everybody is sleep deprived in the whole family, you know. Like, and then if they're on antihistamines, they're going to have trouble focusing also. They might mm-hmm. sleep, but then they got them too late and then they're sleepy in school. So this was a very impactful study and something that should be looked at. And also I wonder with, you know, some of the products that people are using on the kids too, mm-hmm. to, you know, the baby products and the baby cream and the smelly baby shampoo.
Yeah. You know, the problem is that consumers are not really cognizant of the fact that fragrances, even if they're in baby products, are potentially harmful to those patients with atopic dermatitis. You know, we all know as dermatologists, as physicians, that people with atopic dermatitis have very sensitive skin, that they're going to react to a lot of things that someone without atopic dermatitis would never react to. But they're trying to do the best for their children, you know, so they mm-hmm. They really respond to marketing. I won't say a brand, but there's a particular brand of soap out, and I'll tell you that if I had to take a survey, and maybe I will do this work, if I had to take a survey of the brand of soap that most people use, it's probably 75% this brand, and it's because their marketing is so fabulous. Mm-hmm. And it's not something that I think dermatologists would recommend, certainly not for people with atopic dermatitis or easily irritated skin. And patients are now taking to this natural idea. You know, so if something has shea butter in it, if it has cocoa butter in it, it really is something that people of African descent respond to because it's culturally something that has been used for years in families. And those things can be good moisturizers when they're used in the right patient population. But in atopic dermatitis patients, those things in it may have a lot of fragrances, a lot of other chemicals that our patients with atopic dermatitis need to avoid. They're using all manner of topicals because everybody makes them in their kitchen. People sell them at flea markets. They sell them online. You can go to the supermarket and get them. You know, all of our so-called organic stores sell them. And, you know, and the people, the patients, the consumers have no idea what's good, so they just buy them and they use them, and they can often make things a lot worse.
That is so true, and often they say, oh, this is, but I, this is natural, and I always say, well, poison ivy is natural also. So
that's right, and lions and tigers are natural, and they will kill you. So we don't want natural to equate natural with best. We want to equate the treatment that is best for the patient to the disease that they have, you know, and that's what I tell my patients. I want the best for you, not the best marketing campaign. Those are not going to be helpful to us.
Oh, that's a good, well, I'm going to add that to my armamentarium. So can you describe for our audience what the difference is about the clinical presentation of atopic dermatitis in darker skin types? And I guess one sub-question would be, how do you recognize erythema or redness in dark skin?
Well, of course, you know, patients of African descent are all colors of the spectrum. So, you know, some patients you're going to be able to see it right off. They're going to look red, pink, purplish. But when you get to darker skin colors, you're going to have a harder time seeing it. And so sometimes it's going to look more violaceous, and sometimes it's just going to be simply pigmented. I don't think that there is a rule of thumb. I think these things are learned, and I think that the teachers that are teaching the residents training in dermatology right now need to help their residents understand what all skin types look like with every disease. But I do think that you have to be cognizant of pigment being present and wondering, okay, is this post-inflammatory or is this truly inflammatory? Because oftentimes it is inflammatory, especially when it's accompanied by lichenification, which is much more common in our skin of color atopic dermatitis patients, and more papular and follicularly based papules in our atopic dermatitis patients of color as well. So I think we have to just open our minds up to all the ways that atopic dermatitis can look in every skin type, and I think then we don't miss it, and we don't minimize how severe it is when we're taking care of those patients.
You know, so much of the resident training now is all through the computer and on a screen, so I think it's so important, too, that they have the apprenticeship, you know, of being with attendings who can help teach them on live patients, you know, what the difference is too. So I agree, and I think that's going on more in programs now too. I mean, you can tell some of the differences, but they're very subtle on the screen, and it might be more recognizable with the more patients that you see.
Right, and I think that you also get more out of it when you have a relationship with the person teaching you. Certainly you can do Kodachromes all day, and you can see, thank goodness, more and more Kodachrome sets are including patients of color. But I do think that there's something about that one-on-one learning that occurs in a clinical setting where the patient's right in front of you. You walk in, you assess the patient, and then you come out and you present to your faculty member. And the faculty member helps you to understand, no, this patient doesn't have moderate disease. They have severe disease, and this is why. You know, the pigmentation is actually representative of the inflammation. All of these excoriations are representative of the pruritus associated with this. And I think just looking at the clinical cues on different areas of the body, you know, how the family is interacting, how poorly they are responding to the current treatments, all of that has to be wrapped up in a little bit of a bow for you to get the hint. And you can't just get that from looking at a picture on the screen. You don't get how they can't use any topical moisturizers that you've recommended because they're what Mary Spraker at Emory calls stingers. You know, everything stings them. Well, what do you use in stingers, you know? And those are the things that you have to go through to understand what these patients are really suffering through every day.
Yeah, I think we're probably talking to an audience that will understand that, too.
Mm-hmm.
So children with atopic dermatitis, should they avoid athletics or certain athletics?
I would not want to say that children with atopic dermatitis should avoid athletics. I think that there are certain things that we need to do to make sure that they can actually participate. And so I think that in order to participate in athletics, they need to be under good control. Certainly if they're not well controlled and exacerbating effects of atopic dermatitis like perspiration and heat cause more itch and irritation, then certainly they should sit out their gym class or minimize their strenuous physical exercise. But for those people who are amazing athletes and they really want to do something, I think that means we need to be more aggressive in our treatment. We may need to pull out systemic treatments more quickly. And now that we have dupilumab available for teens, I think that we need to actually think about doing that in the appropriate circumstances, because for the first time, we can get almost clear skin in those who are the worst affected by the disease process. So, yes, we have to be cognizant of when flares occur that, perhaps these patients should not participate in activities at that time. But if they want to, and certainly it's healthy to do so, then we need to step up to the plate and treat them appropriately.
Yes, and I wonder with them, we had a teen who was very interesting. It was between his acne and swimming. He's a swimmer. And the chlorine, it was a really hard call. He's sort of well-controlled, but he was kind of interested in, stopping, but didn't really want to stop. I mean, he's like 15, but I'm really happy we do have a way now to help him.
It's time to retrain our patients and let them understand this is not a scary medicine. It could be a potentially life-saving medicine, and that it's going to be something you want to consider for your child.
Yeah. So what about the adolescents with atopic dermatitis and makeup products, cosmetics, makeup, and even hair, artificial hair?
Yeah. We know, certainly as dermatologists, that allergens are really just rip-roaring through cosmetics, even pharmaceutical topical agents. And one study that we quoted was a Brazilian study found that about 89% of 813 prescription and non-prescription products contain allergens. So things like fragrances, propylene glycol, parabens, et cetera. And, of course, we know the patients with atopic dermatitis have a higher prevalence of contact dermatitis or contact sensitization to fragrances, including balsam of Peru. So, we have to be so clear to our patients. If you don't ask what they're doing at home or what they're using at home, they assume that you are okay with it. So my residents know that every atopic dermatitis patient, every acne patient that I'm going to treat, I ask them, what are you cleaning your face with? What are you using as a moisturizer? Do you put anything else on your face? Do you put anything else on your skin? Because if you don't, they assume by scent that you are okay with it. So what we recommend is that you try to give patients recommendations of affordable things that have very little fragrance in them, things that we know are going to be true allergens. And then if we still can't get them realized, where they are moisturized enough, then we need to do patch testing. I mean, it's plain and simple. Mm-hmm. It's hard to sometimes get the skin clear enough to do it, but we do need to do that to allow them to get the right treatments. We've got people looking at all kinds of things, all kinds of oils, coconut oils, sunflower oils, and all of these things. And they're being marketed to the patients with dry skin or damaged skin and that sort of thing. And so we really don't want to use those. We want to try to push them towards ceramide, precursor products, things that we know are formulated to really hold the moisture in after the patient has washed and give them the best outcome that we can without having them veer on their own, to run to the store and get things that are controversial at best in a normal skin patient and, even worse in a patient with atopic dermatitis.
Well, this has been so informative. Are there any other pearls or information that you want to share with the group?
You know, we're at a turning point, I think, where we're finally getting drugs to treat the diseases that we take care of, and we need to be able to talk to our patients in a way that they can understand it. You know, as the move to more natural things occurs, people are getting more and more frightened of medications. You know, we've got these commercials that come on television where, you know, maybe 15 diagnosis list of things that could happen to you when you start a biologic medication, for instance, is offered. And so they're hearing this, and they're doing Google searches, and they're looking up things online, and they're finding all kinds of things. And so we have to be patient with them because they're not getting the right information from these things, but they are getting information, and we have to take the time to debunk it, you know, in a way that is not accusatory to them and doesn't make them feel bad, but allows them to understand, yes, there's this information online, but what we know from many years of practice and from taking care of patients just like your daughter or your son is that this is what's going to be best in the long run. And you have to encourage them that it's not all about steroids. We have other options now and that they need to consider them. But I find it a very challenging thing to sit down and talk to atopic dermatitis patients and their parents without there being a lot of emotion tied into it. I mean, they're very emotionally tied to this disease, and rightly so.
Yes, that's very true. And they will take a lot of time. I mean, I think you have to spend extra time, especially for the kids with atopic dermatitis and their family, because they're coming with the parent, and so you've got to, and you have to win the confidence of the adolescent also, you know.
Right, exactly. And I think it's dealing with, you know, the whole idea of atopic dermatitis being truly just an allergy to something, you know, is a big myth. And when people come to you thinking that you're going to be the one to find the one thing that they're allergic to that causes their skin to look like this, and if we remove it, the skin will be normal, is something that we also have to deal with. And I work very closely with our allergists to allow patients to go see the allergist if they want to. If they feel like they want to go see the allergist, that's fine. Let's not say, well, that's a silly idea, this is not an allergy. Well, they probably have allergies anyway. So, yeah, go and see, and if there's some things that you can avoid and get better, that's great, but then make sure you come back because the allergist doesn't treat your atopic dermatitis. They look at your allergies. And we want to make sure that we give them confidence and whatever it is they come in with that's not a bad idea and help them gently minimize the ideas that are not good for the patient. So I think it's a very delicate balance, and any education that we can provide to these patients is going to help in the long run. You know, these patients actually grow up and do better and be more successful in life because these patients have a hard time concentrating, and so it makes it difficult for them to get through school, makes them get difficult to get through training, and we want them to be successful.
Well, that's a very important point to end on and move forward in terms of success of treating our patients with atopic dermatitis. Thank you, Dr. McMichael. This is really informative.
Oh, it's been my pleasure, and thank you.
And that concludes this week's episode of Dermatology Weekly. To get past and future episodes of Dermatology Weekly, subscribe now on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, YouTube, or wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Terry Rudd.
For Dr. DeLeo, MD Edge editor Melissa Sears, and all of us here at MD Edge, I'm Elizabeth Mishkati. Thanks for listening.